Beautiful. It's good to have you back home. Good to have you here, Aria. We've missed you. Beautiful. Thank you, Jim. Beautiful. Welcome. Welcome this evening to our Wednesday night Going Within service. Our offering this evening is for you to have a chance midweek to just come together and release. Let go of whatever's happened this week, whatever's happened to you since last time we were together, and just allow yourself to be fully present in this moment, to reconnect, to renew, to recharge, to just allow yourself to feel that presence of the divine in you and through you. So welcome. To start us off this evening, we have practitioner Jan Hartman.
Let's take a minute and move into some wonder, some grace, some energy of life through that one source that I call God, that source that is the infinite power and creation and creator at the same time, that energy of life that brings each one here this evening at the sound of my voice and in this room, brings each one to a place of contentment, of openness, of integrity, and alignment with the truth that we are one, that each of us has a component in, as, and through spirit, that each one of us is that God expressing, however that may unfold in our life. And so we bless that tonight, and we are joyous about that, for that's why we're here, to bring love, light, joy, and community, and to shine the energy and the love and the sourcing of our Creator everywhere we go, in everything that we do, in everything that we are, because our job here is to simply be and be love, and be that mechanism, that vehicle for each one to know that for oneself. So I simply release all of this into this evening, into this time of light and this time of togetherness. And so it is. And if you haven't had an opportunity to light your candle, you may come up and do so. And then Aria and Jim are going to lead us into some meditation time, and then they will musically also bring us out.
There is only it's me I see. There is only one of us. hatred, let me so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, fear. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy.
Hello, I'm Jan, and I'm a practitioner here at Seaside. And in speaking with Debbie this week about her message that has to do with not limiting principle, we talked about the interconnectedness of things. We talked about unity a little bit and talked about how important oneness is, that we remember and are cognizant of our oneness, that each of us is part of God expressing. And so I got this little idea, and hopefully most of you got one of these when you came in, because I wanted to use it as just a little bit of a visual about something that I was reading about today called scarcity, because one of the places where we can be the most scarce is when we exclude things from the circle of life. And so I was thinking about these pieces of yarn as a circle. It doesn't need to be around your neck. It doesn't need to be anything, but just aware that it's a circle. And what I wanted to say about the circle before I read you a little meditation about the circle is that if you put yourself in the circle of life, whether you do it this way or you do it this way, or you think about a circle and realize that everything is in the circle of God's life, then there's no way for you to be out of that circle unless it's your choice. So the only way to get out of the circle is to choose to be out of the circle for whatever chunk of time you decide to be gone from there, because nobody else leaves that circle and nothing else leaves that circle, and God is that circle. And so that was a way of looking at limits and how we can sometimes limit ourselves. So I have a little meditation about oneness, a little prayer about oneness that I'd like to read from Ernest Holmes. I know that there is a power for good which is responding to me and bringing into my experience everything that is necessary to my unfoldment, to my happiness, to my peace, to my health, and to my success. I know there is a power for good that enables me to help others and to bless the whole world. So I say quietly to myself, there is one life, that life is God, that life is perfect, that life is my life now. It is flowing through me, circulating in me. I am one with its rhythm. My heart beats with the pulsation of the universe in serenity, in peace, and in joy. My whole physical being is animated by the divine spirit, and if there is anything in it that does not belong, it is cast out, because there is one perfect life in me now. And I say to myself, I am daily guided so that I shall know what to do under every circumstance, in every situation. Divine intelligence guides me in love, in joy, and in complete self-expression. Desiring that the law of good alone shall control me, I bless and prosper everything I am doing. I multiply every activity. I accept and expect happiness and complete success. Realizing that I am one with all people, I affirm that there is a silent power flowing through me and them, which blesses and heals and prospers, makes happy and glad their pathway. And realizing that the world is made of people like myself, I bless the world and affirm that it shall come under the divine government of good, under the divine providence of love, and under the divine leadership of the Supreme Intelligence. For thine is the kingdom and the power, and it is so. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jan. The circle of life. Welcome. Welcome. We're into a new month. This year, we've been following along with Centers for Spiritual Living on the Global Vision, a world that works for everyone. And let's have that first slide, Ed, can we? This month, April, is kinship with all life. Kinship with all life. And the next slide talks about those parts of what we believe in our global vision that they've merged together. And this is what we're looking at this month. We believe that the manifest universe is the body of God. We see a world in which we live and grow as one global family that respects and honors the interconnectedness of life. We see a world in which kinship with all life prospers. So tonight we're going to be taking a look at that center part, the part that says, thank you, we see a world in which we live and grow as one global family that respects and honors the interconnectedness of life. We're going to take a look at that interconnectedness of life and talk about that a little bit. It's good to see you here. Before I begin, I want to just mention that Reverend Lori Mack has put together a Facebook page for our Going Within gathering, our Going Within service. So over the weeks, we're going to encourage you to like it, to invite your friends to like it, but we're gathering pictures for the Facebook page. So if you keep seeing the flash going off, that's what's happening. We're getting pictures so we can post them up on our Facebook page. So the kinship of life, the interconnectedness of life. I want to start with a story about a husband and wife, Kay and Reverend Gary Crawford. Their story illustrates, I think, this interconnectedness that we have with each other. And the story goes that one day Kay received a phone call from the local sheriff. Her husband had been arrested. And as I said, he was a minister, he was a reverend, and he'd been suffering for several months with ideas of suicide, with not wanting to live, and they felt that he had passed that he was in a good place. So she was really surprised when the call came. He was arrested for drunk in public, an assault of an officer, and several other things. 20 hours later, she went to the courtroom, and she went to where he was being arraigned, and she waited. And as she was waiting, the sheriff, the arresting officer, approached her and asked if they could talk. And he took her in another room in which he said, you know, before
you go in there, I just wanted to talk to you about what it is that you'll be facing when you see your husband. What happened was, as I was patrol, I was late on patrol, and I went down a path that I normally don't go down. I'd had a 60-hour week. I was ready to go home. I was hoping to finish my shift without incident. But something caught my attention down this road. Something glittered, and I went down there. And there I encountered your husband, who was enraged, who sicked his dog on me and proceeded to attack me. There was a group of college boys nearby that was swimming, and they came to the rescue and held on to the dog. And once they got a hold of the dog, then I was able to deal just with your husband. And he was screaming and yelling at me. But I noticed then that something was different. Even though he was so angry and he was hitting me and yelling at me, he never cursed. There was something just different about him. And he yelled at me, "Just shoot me, just shoot me," and ripped my uniform. He wanted to egg the officer on to kill him. And the officer understood in that moment that what the gentleman wanted was for him to do the act that the gentleman himself was afraid to do. Based on the minister's training and his background, he was afraid to take his own life, so he was encouraging the officer to do that for him. The officer finally was able to struggle him to the ground, and the officer said, "What happened then is I laid on top of him, spread eagle, and something just came over me, and I began to sing church hymns from my childhood." And he says, "I'm a very religious man, but I don't usually bring it to my work." And as he sung the hymns, Reverend Gary relaxed, and he was able to take him into custody. Now, here he faced 2 years in jail for felony assault on an officer. And when he went into the courtroom, the judge saw that he had not even a speeding ticket. And he removed the felony charges, but he did sentence him to receive some mental health. And so for the next 2 years, he was in a program where he got help for what it is that ailed him, his depression and his suicidal thoughts. And today, he lives a joyous life. But what the point of the story that I really want you to take away is, what was that thing that had the officer go down that road? What was the thing that had him sing a hymn? Laying on top of the man he was arresting, nothing he'd ever done in his career before. What is that interconnectedness of life that we experience? Do you have that in your life? Do you have a friend who you finish each other's sentences, that you know what they're thinking before they even tell you what they're thinking? I have a friend like that. You know, that there's something deeper. There's a connection between us. What is that thing? What is that thing, the kinship of all life, that our theme is for this month? Ernest Holmes says this, and I love this. I haven't heard it put so simply. We see that the first principle of life is oneness. The first performance of life is multiplying itself without dividing itself. Life must be one, and that one, in order to be expressed, must be many. But the many, in order to exist, must live in the one. The circle Jan was talking about. We must live in the circle. As Jan was doing her reading, now I don't know what the practitioners are going to read mostly when they get here. We haven't talked about it. And I had in my talk notes the Lion King and the circle of life that I removed. And there it was, you know, Jan talked about it. And also the quote that she read, "There is one life, God's life, and that life is my life," was going to be my affirmation for tonight. Now how does that happen? That one mind, that interconnectedness that we have. You know, it's so obvious in nature, I think. I take a lot of my lessons from nature because I think there we see the universe in action without our interference, right? We just see things as they're supposed to be in the animals and the plant lives in our world. You know, we see the interconnectedness in pollination. You know, we have the bees and the birds and the bats and the wind that move the pollen from one flower to the other flower, therefore fertilizing the flowers, and we get more flowers. And at the same time, the bee is there, and he's got the pollen on his wings, and he's moving it around from place to place. And also he takes the pollen and the nectar back to feed the children in the hive. That interconnectedness, one cannot exist without the other. They're all part of it. You know, the whole idea of photosynthesis. where the sunlight hits the trees, the green leaves, and the green leaves create then the oxygen for us to breathe. The interconnectedness of life. It's so plain for me to see it in nature. I don't always see it so, I don't see it so clearly without a focused attention on it in our human experience. In Ernest Holmes says, all nature shows a divine relatedness. I have but to contemplate the blades of grass, the growing leaf, or the solar system to see that who has created me has shaped and arranged all things to prosper and to exist in harmony. And so our natural state, I believe, is to exist in harmony with each other. If we would just allow it to be so. If we would just allow it to be so. The Native Americans, I think, had a very clear understanding of the interconnectedness of all of life, with animals and the plants and just everything with each other. There's a slide I have from Chief Seattle where he says, all things share the same breath, the beast, the tree, the man. The air shares its spirit with all life it supports. So the Native Americans, I think, practiced, in a way, a lost art that some of us practice today, and depending what circles you travel in, more and more it's practiced. You know, the whole circle of giving and receiving and being, taking what only is needed, using everything that you take in cooperation with. I started to think about sayings that I heard, you know, because when I heard as a young child growing up in the Catholic faith that everyone was my brother and sister, I didn't really get it. You know, I didn't really get what they meant. I mean, I kind of sensed that there was a God thing that was within all of us, but that's about as much as I took away from it. So as I thought about these sayings that I knew from my childhood, there's the one that no man is an island, right? We've all heard that. No man is an island. No man can exist without others. And the poem actually goes like this. No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is less. As well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thy friends or thine own were, any man's death diminishes me. Because I am involved in mankind, and therefore never send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. So this idea that we're connected has been spoken about for centuries, that one death diminishes me, that there's a connection between you and a connection between me, a connection between each other, a connection between me and the stranger on the street. Then the other thing that came to me was, whatsoever you do unto my brethren, you do unto me. You know, the good Bible stuff that I learned when I was little. The other one is, am I my brother's keeper? Those ideas of connectedness, you know. And in the story of whatsoever you do unto my brethren, you do unto me, you know, where there Jesus was condemning those who did not clothe the naked and did not feed the hungry and did not house the homeless and praising those that did. So what does that mean? What does that mean? Are we supposed to, like, clothe every homeless person that we see? Are we supposed to take them into our house? Are we supposed to feed them? What are we supposed to do? What is the spiritual principle, then, that we are all brothers and sisters in God? What does that mean? You know, Dr. Ken Gordon does the monthly video for the themes, and I've been posting them on my Reverend Debbie Facebook page, and we'll get them over to the Wednesday night service page soon. But if you go on the Reverend Debbie Facebook page, you can see Dr. Ken Gordon, who's our spiritual leader, his message for April, and he talks about the kinship of all life, and he talks about the idea of the responsibility that we have of taking care of our planet. You know, Dr. Ken talks about we must move from a competitive urge to a creative urge. I really liked that. If you think about that, moving out of competition, I mean, we've often heard, or I've heard said in my training, you know, any place that you're in competition, get out. Get out. You know, our job is not to be in competition with each other, but can our job be to be creative? You know, how are we participating in the world? What are we doing? What are we doing to make the world a better place? Maybe we're giving. Maybe we're giving to the Community Resource Center. Maybe that's how we're helping. Maybe we're working the soup kitchens. Maybe that's how we're helping. What is it that you're called to do? How are you being of service in the world? I think is the greater question. How am I serving God and man? When I say man, I mean women too. You know, all of humankind. How are we serving? How are we serving? How are we showing up? You know, when you pass a homeless person or you sit in your car parked at the freeway exit and there's people are standing there with a sign, what do you do? It's a great experiment to just see how you feel. Do you avoid eye contact completely? Pretend that you don't see them, like at your phone, whatever you do. Do you make eye contact? Do you smile? Do you give them a dollar or two? And I'm not saying that you need to. It's just an opportunity to check in with yourself. What are your thoughts? One of the things that I do that works for me because of some training that I have with alcoholics and drug addicts, I don't necessarily give the money to the man I see on the street, but something that I value is giving to the places that do support and help those that need help. So I know that the money is going to a place that works. You know, my spiritual mentor used to say, I could tell you what you value by looking at your checkbook. What are you writing your checks to? Where's your money going? Because we can talk a good talk, but are we really supporting that thing? You know, I thought about that for myself today, and a lot of my checkbooks are going to pay the bills, you know, but then I spend a large portion on making my home nice. I value being in a nice environment. I like that. I tithe. I'm a very active tither, so I do give to Seaside. I give to other charities that are important to me. You know, but it's a fun exercise. Look at your checkbook. Where is your money going? Where are you spending it? I have another slide here from Chief Seattle, a quote that I think is really beautiful that talks about this illustration or illustrates what I'm talking about. Humankind has not woven the web of life. We are but one thread within it. Whatever we do to the web, we do to ourselves. All things are bound together. All things connect. You know, we are one thread in that. You can't damage one string of a spider web without damaging the spider web. It's connected. There's a story of a gentleman. His name is Chris Rosati from Durham, North Carolina. And he's a gentleman that has ASL, ASL degrees? Yeah, disease. And ALS, thank you. Thank you, I knew I was saying it wrong. And his thing in life is to spread kindness. And then he got to learn about the butterfly effect. And you all know what the butterfly effect is. You know, if a butterfly flaps its wings here on the West Coast, perhaps it could cause a hurricane around the world that we don't know. You know, that small act has a ripple effect. And so he wanted to do an experiment on kindness, the butterfly effect in kindness. And so one day he was at his local diner and he saw two girls, a 13-year-old and a 10-year-old sisters, and he gave them each $50. And he said the only requirement is that they needed to do some act of kindness with the $50. And then he left and he forgot about it. Till months later, he received an email. And the email was this picture of this village in Africa. The two girls had heard of this village in Africa because their father had served there when he was in the Peace Corps. The village is Sierra Leone. And they knew that this village was combating Ebola. So they knew that the village had gotten a good handle on it, and they were going to be Ebola free. So the girls sent their money for a feast of celebration. And then what happened is they took these pictures, and they said thank you very much to the gentleman, Chris Rosati, for the feast. And they sent this email to him. You know, the butterfly effect of kindness. We never know where it's going to end up, what's going to happen. a short exercise I want to do with you. In the Buddhist Hindu culture, there's a thing called Indra's net. Dr. Kathy talks about it a lot, Dr. Kathy Hearn, if you've ever studied with her. And I have a picture just sort of to give a visual. That's not exactly what it looks like. But the story goes that far away in the adobe of the great god Indra, the king of heaven, hangs a wondrous vast net, much like a spider web in intricacy and loveliness. It stretches out indefinitely in all directions. At each node or crossing point, each interconnection there is a jewel. Since the net is infinite in dimension, the jewels are infinite in number. The sparkling jewels hang there, suspended in and supported by the net, glittering like stars, dazzling to behold. So I'm just going to invite you to close your eyes. If you feel comfortable, you, of course, you never have to do anything. Close your eyes and imagine what the magnificent jewel net looks like. Just imagine what this Indra's net looks like spread across the globe. Magnificent, gigantic, vast. Now, focus in, if you can, on one jewel. Bring your attention to one of those jewels on the net. Look closely, and you will see that the polished surface of the gem reflects all the other jewels in the net, infinite in number, just as two mirrors facing each other would reflect. So it goes on and on and on. Now recognize that you are one of those sparkling jewels in Indra's net, that each and every soul is one of those jewels on the net. And that interconnectedness, that a change in one jewel or one person produces a change, however slightly, in the net. Whatever you do to one jewel affects the entire net, as well as yourself. You cannot damage one strand without injuring the entire web. You cannot damage one strand of the web that is in the universe without injuring all others in it, whether that injury is known or unknown. That can work for good or ill, because, of course, just as destructive acts affect the entire net, so do loving, constructive, compassionate acts infect the entire net. A single helpful act, even a simple act of kindness, will send positive ripples across the entire net, touching each and every jewel, each and every person in that net. You can just allow yourself to open your eyes and come back to this space and time. And take with you that image of the interconnectedness of all of life, how each one of us are connected to the other. And that one of us leaving diminishes the whole. You know, there was an interview with Richard Gere, and Richard Gere studies Buddhism. And he started a practice a few years ago, and I'm going to invite you to do this practice this week or 2 weeks until I see you again. And what he does is he, before he opens his mouth to interact with anybody, he says, insects, animals, plants, people, he says, and he thinks, he doesn't say it out loud, he thinks to himself, I wish you happiness. I wish you happiness. And he says that it changes the whole interaction of the experience. It's like a blessing before. It's a blessing before you have that interaction. Try it this week and next to just try to remember before you interact with someone to give them a blessing, whether it's I wish you happiness or namaste, I salute the divinity in you, or just remembering that's God talking to God. Whatever it is, but just take that moment
Just take that moment to know that we are all connected, that there's nothing that I can do that stands alone from the rest of you, that we are all one, this kinship of life. So bless you for being here. So beautiful to have you. We're going to invite Aria back up for song. But before we do that, I want to do an affirmation with you. Do we have that affirmation? Okay. I am one with all that is. We say that together? I am one with all that is. Do it one more time. I am one with all that is. Amen. Aria.
Discouraged, when I start to doubt, when I get confused, don't know what life's all about, I set my mind upon this truth, sets my heart at ease, and I affirm that God is all, and God lives in me. God is all there is. God is all there is.
Sing that together.
God is all there is. One mind, one love, one power, and one life. God is all there is. God is all there is. And from this loving presence flows my life. From this loving presence flows.
Thank you both. God is all there is. That's right. God is all there is.
That's right.
Oh, so it is time, I believe, for our offering. And invite our ushers to come forward tonight. We have Trudy and Karen. Thank you, ladies, for being here and supporting our Wednesday night service. So this is the time of our service where you get to give. It is the time that we collect our offerings and know that anything that you're able to give goes to support the work here at Seaside, goes to keep the doors open on Wednesday nights and Sunday nights, and supports all the work that we do in the world. We are operating under that law of reciprocity, that as you give, you receive. Certainly not the reason to give, but it is a wonderful way to get that flow going in your life. So please give whatever you can. It is greatly appreciated. Let's say together our prosperity prayer. As I give thanks for the good now flowing into my life, I gladly share that good with others. The more I give, the more I receive. I experience a deeper consciousness of peace and security.
for I know that I am in the embrace of a warm, loving presence forever seeking an outlet through me. My cup runneth over. I exist in limitless possibilities. God bless you. Thank you. I just have a few announcements and thank yous before we do our prayer and our closing. I want to remind you that it's spring quarter. Classes have started this week. A few of you were in Dr. Christian's class last night. It was a big class. He had over 100 people show up, and there's a few more that didn't make it the first week. But there is still about 10, 15 spots left. It's not too late to join. It's a class, his mysticism class, based on his new book, Living from the Mountaintop. See me afterwards if you want to get on the list. I'd be glad to put you on there for next week. It's done in 2 5-week sessions, so you can sign up for the first 5 weeks and then make a decision if you want to do the second 5 or not. Also, we have an art class that's going on Tuesday nights. Thursday night, Kelly Jean, who is our local nutrition gal. She's doing fitness over 40. You can sign up for that. She did a 21-day cleanse last quarter, and people just loved her. So I invite you to be part of that if health and wellness is what you're looking at. Our very own Jan Hartman, practitioner, is beginning her bereavement group once again, another 4-week session. It begins this Thursday, 10 a.m. here in the Emerson Room. Can you come? You sign up for all 4 or 1 or just how does it go? Whatever works. So if you're able to be that and you're wanting support on any transition that might be going in your life, any grief that you might be experiencing, talk to Jan afterwards. Jan and Kathleen Lees, our practitioners, are both available for prayer out the side door here tonight. That is what they love to do. Pray for you and with you. Trudy's here too. I don't know if she'll join in on prayer, but please don't leave here with anything on your heart. If you would like, you can put a written prayer request in the chest, and those are distributed confidentially to all our practitioners as well. Thank you to everybody who made Wednesday night service possible. It couldn't happen without you. Ed, thank you so much for being here and filling in and being with us. Melanie's back. Thank you, Melanie. So good to see you. Gregory, thank you for your podcast. They're beautiful. I've watched them, and you're doing a great job. Thank you to everybody that watches at home. Jan and Kathleen, thank you for being the practitioners and holding the consciousness for us. Aria, we're so glad you're back. Aria got back from shamanic training, so she is here and with us. We're very grateful. Jim, thank you. Good to hear. I think your buddy's here. I hear a little buddy? I did. Okay. Welcome. And Jenny, she's off doing the money, but we always thank Jenny for being here. Terry's here. The bookstore is open. We've got all kinds of great stuff. Barbara's brought in stuff for graduation and all kinds of stuff. So if you're looking for gifts, we have them. But now we're going to pray. So I invite you to bring into your consciousness anybody in your life that you would like prayer for yourself, for a loved one, for a friend. And please know that as we hold them in consciousness, that they're included in this vortex, this circle that we're creating here right now. I know that there is only one power and one presence, and it is God. And God is all that there is, that there is nothing, absolutely nothing but the divine. There is only one, and that one is God. Love, light, goodness, joy, whatever name we want to call it, there is one. And I know that I am one with all that is. I know that I am one with this source. I know that I am one with this love. And just as I know that this is true for me, I know it's true for each one here. I know that each one in this sanctuary is a manifestation of the divine, separate yet connected. I'm knowing that each one lives and breathes and has their very being in this essence of the divine, that each and every life is sourced by God, that there's an absolute abundance moving in through and as each and every individual's life here, that there's a wholeness, a health, prosperity. Every quality of God is manifesting and operating in through and as each individual here. I know for everybody who's written a prayer in our prayer request chest that that prayer is answered. I know for Seaside Center for Spiritual Living that it is a place of expansion, a place of growth, a place of abundance. I know that anyone whose relative or friend is suffering, that there's a healing taking place. that there's goodness happening now. I know for our own Mary Palmer and for Sharon Powell and those that are experiencing anything but perfect health, that Spirit is moving through them now in this moment and a perfect healing is taking place. I'm so grateful to know this truth. I am so grateful to know with absolute certainty that that one power and that one presence is operating here, now, and always. And it's with that sense of knowingness, with a heart full of gratitude, that I just simply release these words into the divine nature of the law, knowing it's already done. And so it is.
So it is.
So our closing song, stand and join me. My girls.
Is my decision. It's up to me to give up my heart. Love is my decision, and no one else can tell me to start. And once I decide to change my mind, love will show me how. Love is my decision. My decision right here and now. Love is my decision. It's up to me to dance down that road. Love is my decision. No one else can lighten my load. And once I decide to change my mind, love will show me how. Love is my decision. My decision right here and now. My decision right here and now.
God bless you. Join us for refreshments in the family room. Thank you.
It's the wheel of fortune. It's a leap of faith. It's the band of hope. Till we find our place on the path unwinding.
Thank you, Aria.